In the modern battle fleet, the aircraft carrier takes pride of place. It is now unthinkable that a modern superpower could join battle without the aircraft carrier at the heart of its fleet. Yet despite its crucial role, the aircraft carrier is a comparatively young invention. Carriers only rose to prominence during the maelstrom of World War II, when the cunning of the Japanese Imperial Navy unleashed the full power of the carrier on the unsuspecting world. In the dim morning light of December 5th, 1941, far out in the North Pacific, a powerful Japanese fleet was steaming rapidly eastwards with great stealth. The commander, Admiral Nagumo, deliberately steered a course to minimize the risk of observation by foreign ships or aircraft. The destination, Pearl Harbor. The huge Japanese armada under Nagumo's command was radically different from any naval task force ever before assembled. At its core, rode a group of six large ultra-modern aircraft carriers, which between them could fly off more than 360 warplanes. The long sea-going reach of the carriers, matched with the formidable strike capacity of their air complement, gave the combined fleet an offensive capability unprecedented in naval history. The concept of a mass airstrike mounted exclusively from ships was still novel, and Admiral Nagumo was not convinced it would prove effective. Nevertheless, he prepared his fleet for action, following a meticulously prepared timetable. The attack could only be stopped by express orders from the commander-in-chief in Tokyo, Admiral Isoroku Yamamoto. For some time, Japan and the United States had been moving closer to war. Japan nurtured ambitions to become the dominant regional power in Asia, and her aggressive expansion on the Chinese mainland roused American anxieties. So far, American retaliation had been limited to crippling economic sanctions. High-level negotiations between the two sides were continued in Washington, but by midnight on December 6th, both sides knew they would surely fail. As the talks continued, the task force swung around on the more southerly course, heading for a bearing 200 miles from the Hawaiian Islands. Far away in Tokyo, Yamamoto closely monitored his fleet's progress. The admiral was Japan's most gifted commander. It was because of his energy and foresight that the Imperial Navy possessed its magnificent carrier force. The strategy devised for the forthcoming campaign was also largely Yamamoto's creation. He knew that the Soviet Union and Britain were desperately embroiled in their mortal struggle against Hitler's Germany. In the early months of the war, Japan's principal enemy would be the United States. In the coming war, Yamamoto believed that Japan's best, and perhaps only chance, was to strike first and to strike hard, so that a weakened America might just be persuaded to sue for peace. With hindsight, it was a long shot, but in December 1942, the Japanese High Command were convinced it would succeed. A vital centerpiece of the hit-first strategy was a surprise attack against the American base at Pearl Harbor, home of the US Pacific Fleet. The entire air strength of Yamamoto's carrier force was committed to this single operation. The entire plan had been carefully tested in a series of war games. Directly after the first raid on Pearl Harbor, Yamamoto intended to launch a rapid series of further attacks against a wide variety of objectives to destroy the US fleet. There was never a serious intention of an assault on the US mainland. Yamamoto's only hope was that by the time America had rebuilt her naval strength, Japan would have secured a great empire, protected by a vast ring of island bases around the Pacific, from which she could successfully negotiate a peace settlement. Success in the initial carrier strike was therefore crucial. Yamamoto's confidence had been strengthened by the performance of similar British carriers in the European War. He had made an intensive study on the raid of Taranto Harbor the previous year, when a strong Italian battleship was disabled by a handful of elderly British biplanes. Yamamoto saw to it that his aircraft carried torpedoes, specifically adapted to drop and run in shallow harbor waters. As the carrier group approached the attack station, Nagumo's ship enjoyed the cover of cloud and gray skies. Ahead and below the warships traveled a stealthy advance guard of Japanese submarines. Yamamoto's major concern was that not all the American fleet would be in the port. Intelligence reports suggested that they were. This was a significant development, as by then, the Washington negotiations had finally broken down. Yamamoto knew he must destroy the American carriers to prevent any US counterstrike. Aboard the Japanese ships, everybody now knew that war was imminent. Expectations rose to fever pitch. Yamamoto signaled his message to the fleet. The fate of the empire hangs on this enterprise. Every man must devote himself unsparingly to the task at hand. On December 6, Tokyo began an extended transmission to its Washington embassy. The message ended with a declaration of war to be presented at 1 o'clock the following day. Because it took so long to decode, the declaration was actually delivered late. By then, the Japanese had struck their first unexpected blow. At 6 o'clock local time, the carriers turned into the wind and increased their speed to 24 knots. The decks vibrated to the roar of powerful engines. On the pilots' headbands were inscribed the Japanese characters meaning certain victory. By 6:30, the first wave of 100 aircraft was aloft and speeding in the skies towards Pearl Harbor. Shortly before 8 o'clock, the attackers reached the target zone. Visibility and weather conditions were ideal, and to their delight, the Japanese found they had caught their enemy hopelessly off guard. Surprise was complete. American resistance was disorganized and ineffectual. On the airfield, both squadrons of American warplanes were destroyed where they stood. In the Great Harbor, Japanese bombs and torpedoes transformed the great battleship row below them into a nightmare inferno of explosions, fires, and smoke. Amid the chaos, the second wave of aircraft found easy prey. When the raiders finally returned to their carriers, they left behind a scene of unparalleled devastation. 8 battleships and 10 other ships had been sunk or badly damaged. Hundreds of aircraft put out of action, many of the port facilities reduced to ruins. In achieving all this, just 29 Japanese aircraft had been lost. This was heartening for Yamamoto, who had been prepared to sacrifice one-third of the task force. Only one thing spoiled the euphoria of the celebrations. none of the reported American aircraft carriers was actually in port during the attack, and all had escaped unscarred. For Yamamoto, this was a matter of serious concern. From Tokyo, he urgently signaled Admiral Nagumo, ordering him to find and sink the American carriers. Yamamoto also urged further strikes against Pearl Harbor, designed to destroy the remaining installations there. Despite the expressed wishes of the commander-in-chief, the strict code of Japanese military etiquette yielded the final decision to the commander at the front and disregarded the huge naval superiority, which presented him with a chance which might never come again. Admiral Nagumo was determined to risk the fleet no more. Satisfied with the glory of the day, Nagumo turned his ships around and headed back for safer waters. In the United States, the first garbled reports on the raid at Pearl Harbor were received with incredulity. However, it quickly became apparent that the American arms had suffered a humiliating defeat. President and public responded with outrage and fury. In Berlin, Hitler received the news of Pearl Harbor with delight and warmly approved of the Japanese methods. "That's the way to do it," he exclaimed. "Strike hard without warning and ask questions afterwards." Hitler, who considered the American President Roosevelt to be incompetent, took grim pleasure in declaring war in the United States on December the 11th. As justification, he submitted a long list of American violations of neutrality. America now found herself embroiled in two conflicts, one in Europe and one in the Pacific. The powerful isolationist lobby, which had long preached that America should stay and not go to war, soon disintegrated. The war effort was in full swing. In Washington, the first of many inquiries into the reasons for the Pearl Harbor debacle was set up. Not for many years would the whole truth emerge. It made sorry reading. Although both British and American codebreakers had detailed full knowledge of the raid, the information was not passed on either to the president or to the commander on the spot at Pearl Harbor. In the interim, however, there was little America could do to immediately strike back until the huge emergency war production got into its stride. Every passing week, it seemingly brought news of fresh Japanese victories and conquests, and the American military were forced to learn some bitter lessons. It had been widely assumed that Japanese ships, aircraft, and weaponry were poor copies of Western models. Each day brought grim evidence to the contrary. Much of the Japanese war machines were far superior to the Western powers. The Allies also underestimated their adversities in a number of other respects. It was assumed, for example, that the physique of the Japanese and their curious eyes rendered it impossible for them to become accomplished aviators. In fact, Japan's magnificently trained carrier pilots were among the best in the world. One major lesson from Pearl Harbor was grasped straight away. The American Navy, like others, had long since debated as to whether the battleship or the aircraft carrier should be given priority. Yamamoto's bombs and torpedoes had settled that question beyond doubt. For the Pacific War, America's main naval production priority were carriers and the aircraft to fly from them. Pondering their future strategic options, American commanders were far from disheartened. They knew that in the long term, the war-making capacity of the United States far exceeded that of Japan. Designers, shipyards, and factories were already working furiously to provide the carriers and aircraft that America would need. Above all, the existing American carrier forces were still intact, and much to the gratification of the military, Pearl Harbor submarine base and merchant ships were left largely undamaged. Even more importantly, so were the vast oil depots. If Nagumo had struck at these huge stocks of fuel, no American naval action could have been contemplated until 1943. In time, the Japanese would pay dearly for Nagumo's caution. but by spring 1942, the seemingly unstoppable tide of conquest was still spreading onwards and upwards. President Roosevelt and his advisors were desperate for any kind of American success and were prepared to sanction an unusual undertaking. On April 18th, 16 B-25 bombers under the command of Colonel James Doolittle performed the hazardous feat of taking off from a carrier deck. After a journey of more than 600 miles, they unloaded their bombs over Tokyo before flying on in a vain effort to reach China. News of the exploit was received in the United States with jubilation and gave an immense boost to public morale. Although Doolittle's bombers did little damage, the portals were ominous, and their foray unsettled the Imperial High Command. Fearful revenge reprisals were made against the civilians on the Chinese mainland. One far-reaching consequence of the Doolittle raid was to persuade Yamamoto that the enemy's carrier group must be forced into battle, while Japan still enjoyed naval superiority. Although the American fleet had been reinforced by two carriers transferred from the Atlantic, Japan still enjoyed a distinct superiority in carrier strength and battleships. Yamamoto's men also had a better understanding of the tactics of carrier warfare. Whereas America was setting up a number of small task forces, each with a single carrier as the nucleus, the Japanese kept their carriers bunched together to produce maximum striking power where it mattered most. In battle, this enabled a sizable contingent of aircraft to maintain air cover over the vital carriers. The Japanese had other advantages. Their carrier aircraft were significantly better than those of the opposition. The fast Zero fighter was a match for any aircraft of any air force currently in service. The construction of the Zero fighter sacrificed everything for lightness. Not even the pilot's seat enjoyed the protection of armor. Consequently, even a single bullet hit could easily prove fatal. Perhaps it was the legacy of the Samurai Code which frowned on cowardice and any sign of weakness, but placing valuable pilots in unarmored cockpits was a false economy on a grand scale. Both sides had devoted intense thought to the training of their airmen, for naval aviation was a difficult art. Merely landing at sea on a relatively small rectangular deck, which may be pitching and yawing in the heavy seas, was a dangerous operation even for the most skilled. A rigorous selection process, followed by a long training during 3 years at sea, ensured that Yamamoto's pilots were of exceptional quality. However, because of an extensive civil industry, America had the immediate benefit of a large pool of trainers, and the first-class training scheme would in time provide excellent pilots in abundance. The Americans also possessed two further advantages, the existence of which was scarcely even guessed at by the Japanese. Firstly, the British had passed on the full secrets of their radar technology, the most advanced in the world, and was still being improved. Radar was invaluable not only to locate the position of the enemy and warn of his approach, but also in allowing aircraft to get safely home to the mothership. The Japanese pilot, after flying hundreds of miles, had to rely on pinpoint accuracy of navigation to find his ship again, usually with no landmarks to help him. All too often, the penalty for pilot error was a lonely death in the vastness of the ocean. The second great advantage of America was their code-breaking task force, which supplied a constant, reliable guide to Japanese intentions and movements. This intelligence was to be instrumental in bringing about a naval engagement of a kind unknown in previous history, a duel between two carrier strike forces. After 4 months of extraordinary unbroken success, the Japanese military had become dangerously overconfident and resolved on a further extension of their defensive perimeter. They envisaged as a first step the occupation of the Pacific island of Tulagi in the Solomons, to be followed by an assault on Port Moresby in Papua New Guinea. The invasion fleet sailed out on May 1, 1942, accompanied by one small and two large carriers. The Americans knew exactly where the Japanese were headed for, and Admiral Fletcher was dispatched to intercept them. Fletcher's task force comprised the carriers Lexington and Yorktown, together with their respective groups of destroyer and cruiser escorts. The first blood was drawn by aircraft from the Yorktown, which on May the 4th sank a destroyer and other vessels of the invasion convoy at Tulagi. Two days later, the Imperial Navy lost a carrier for the first time, when the Shohoh fell victim to a combined airstrike launched by Fletcher's ships. Later, the Americans realized that the Shohoh was not one of the major carriers, and the Japanese must know now that an enemy task force was in the vicinity. There ensued a period of frantic moving and intense aerial activity. The Japanese sank a destroyer, but lost heavily in the air. After one fierce dogfight, some of the surviving Japanese aircraft lost their bearings and mistook the Yorktown for their own vessel. The next day, May the 8th, brought what came to be known as the Battle of the Coral Sea. It was the first time that an action was joined by two groups of ships, which remained far out of sight of each other throughout. The fighting at the Battle of the Coral Sea was carried out by air fleets from the carriers. Flights of aircraft from the two sides located each other's ships at almost precisely the same time. Within the space of half an hour, two waves of aircraft were sent aloft, one Japanese and one American. The Americans reached their quarry first. After two attacks, the carrier Shikoku was hit by three bombs, one of which started a serious fire. On the US side, the Lexington radar picked up the approaching enemy at a range of 60 miles, and the American air patrols took off to intercept it. Unfortunately, the Americans were sent to the wrong altitude, and the Japanese attackers flew on undisturbed above and below the American fighters. One Japanese bomb detonated deep inside the Yorktown, and a blaze developed. Two more bombs hit the Lexington, which also took a torpedo on either side. The Yorktown crew succeeded in extinguishing the fire, and the vessel remained operational. For a while, it seemed that the Lexington would be saved, but following a large explosion, the vessel was abandoned and sunk. Fortunately, her precious crew and aircraft had first been transferred to the Yorktown. To set against the loss of the Lexington, the Americans had sunk only one minor enemy carrier, but they had damaged the Shikoku and forced her to return to Japan for repairs. The second Japanese carrier, the Zuikaka, had also suffered severe damage. Both of these crucial Japanese warships would still be out of action at a crucial time in the war, while the Yorktown could continue on. So overall, the American commanders justly regarded the Battle of the Coral Sea as both a significant victory and a turning point. The first serious hurt had been inflicted on the mighty Japanese carrier force. American pilots had now given proof that they could match their opponents in the air, and the attempted invasion of Port Moresby had been rebuffed. Very soon, the American pilots would outstrip the Japanese, not just in terms of training, but also in numbers. The Imperial Japanese forces were strongly imbued with the old martial tradition of Bushido, whereby it was considered a high honor to die for the emperor. This disdain for personal safety meant that the Japanese did not place such a high price on the moral aspects of saving human lives. The Japanese made few efforts to recover the precious airmen who had come down in the sea. Their system of training was still slow and meticulous, which precluded a rapid replacement to those who were lost. The Imperial Navy had begun to hemorrhage. The Americans, by contrast, made extraordinary efforts to rescue downed pilots. The Americans would risk an expensive submarine simply to pick up a crew. In addition to humanitarian concerns, they were moved by a lively sense of the value of a widely trained, experienced operator. Cumulatively, this difference in attitudes worked ever more to the benefit of the Americans. In Tokyo, the strategic situation was clearly grasped by Admiral Yamamoto. He still deferred unquestioningly to the imperial will, but he had always been strenuously opposed to the war. It was he who had famously predicted that the Japanese forces would be able to run wild for 6 months, but thereafter, the superiority of the military-industrial might of the United States eventually would begin to assert itself with irreversible effect. The 6 months were not quite expired, and Yamamoto had only 4 major carriers operational in the Pacific. Ominous news of fresh carriers under contract in the US sounded grim alarms. Accordingly, Yamamoto drew up a plan intending to force the Americans into the major fleet engagement, while he still had the strength. In the vast Pacific, the tiny atoll of Midway possessed a strategic importance far disproportionate to its size. Yamamoto knew that the Americans could not possibly countenance its capture by the Japanese, as such a move would menace the entire basis of their ocean defense. If Midway was attacked, the American fleet, whatever its condition, must come out and fight. In no other arena of war was so much sophisticated and diverse technology concentrated in one battle, nor so many desperate and finely honed human skills called upon as in the Battle of Midway. Carrier aircraft required exceptional engineering and design. A capability to deliver bombs or torpedoes must be combined with the agility indispensable for aerial combat. Undercarriages needed to be unusually sturdy to cope with the inevitable heavy landings. Airframes had to be able to withstand being jerked to a sudden halt or being hurled into the air by a powerful catapult. The landing officers who guided down aircraft were themselves experienced pilots. On the accuracy of their split-second judgment, an entire succession of men's lives were dependent. On May 20th, a long transmission from Yamamoto to his fleet was intercepted by the American codebreakers. It was clear that a major operation was about to take place. But because Yamamoto was using new letter codes for place names, the objective was unclear. They suspected that the Japanese would go for Midway. By cunning deception, they obtained confirmation. Details of the forthcoming attack was passed on to Chester Nimitz, commander of the US Pacific Fleet. Nimitz took care to position his carriers where the enemy would least expect them. After 3 days of extraordinary efforts, the Yorktown, damaged in the Coral Sea battle, was repaired sufficiently to go once more to war. As the most senior Japanese commander, it was again Admiral Nagumo who led the strike force sailing for Midway. His 4 large carriers, Agaki, Kaga, Soryu, and Hiryu, were all veterans of Pearl Harbor. Because of the larger size of Nagumo's ships, the Japanese had a strong advantage in the strength of carrier aircraft. 270 against the Americans' 180. The ratio was only slightly improved by a number of elderly aircraft, which the Americans flew from the Midway Island itself. The Japanese carrier groups were well supported by battleships, cruisers, and destroyers. The Americans had 3 carriers at sea, Enterprise, Hornet, and Yorktown, again accompanied by numerous cruisers and destroyers. However, the Americans knew the disposition of the enemy ships and where each was steaming. The Japanese, however, did not know what opposition they might encounter. On June 3rd, Nagumo's forces were discovered by an American aircraft, and by June 4th, the distance between the two hostile battle groups had closed to 250 miles. Whether for bad or for ill, the decisive engagement so long sought by Yamamoto was to hand. On this same day's events would rest the mastery of the Pacific. Nagumo believed that he still commanded the element of surprise, but he was soon disabused of that notion as a flight of American bombers arrived from Midway. However, the slow, unwieldy machines were far outclassed by the Japanese Zeros and succeeded only in hitting a small supply vessel. Partly because of this attack, Nagumo decided to reduce the defenses at Midway before proceeding with the invasion, and a strike was launched. Alerted by their radar, Midway defenders flew up to meet the oncoming flow and sustained heavy losses. The Japanese bombs got through, inflicting heavy damage on island installations. However, they failed in their primary objective of bombing the enemy planes on the ground. The Americans had put all their aircraft aloft, and as the Japanese raiders left unscarred, their commander radioed that a second raid would be needed. Nagumo resolved on the second foray on the island and was confirmed in his decisions by another flight of bombers from Midway. These were again easily rebuffed by the fighting of the fleet. The Japanese admiral still had no information about the American carriers, which in the meantime had moved into position and set off their own airstrikes. Nagumo's bombers returned a second time from Midway and were rearming just as the first wave of hostile torpedo bombers came into the attack. In this potentially grave situation, the Zeros, which were still airborne, proved their worth. More than 100 enemy aircraft were shot down, driven off, or forced to ditch without scoring a single hit. Despite all the benefits of their radar and code breaking, the Americans had suffered horrendous losses with nothing to show in return. Then, there occurred an astonishing reversal of fortune. A group of 50 dive bombers from the Enterprise had strayed off course and flown far beyond their target zone. Returning to the fleet, their commander was alerted by the position of a Japanese destroyer. He guessed correctly that she was steaming directly for the main carrier force and was quickly able to find the scene of battle. The Japanese Zeros were all at low altitude, dealing with the remainder of torpedo bombers, while the incoming bombers were all at high altitude. Because the carriers had been servicing relays of fighters, their decks were crisscrossed with fuel hoses and cluttered with bombs. It was precisely 10:25 in the morning when the first American dive bombers swooped down into the attack. Within the space of only 5 minutes, the balance of power in the Pacific had utterly transformed. No less than 3 of the 4 Japanese carriers sustained direct hits. The bombs set off sequences of further explosions and furious fires broke out. A raging conflagration swept through the flagship, Akagi. The firefighters won a sufficient respite for many of the surviving crew to be saved, and Admiral Nagumo himself moved his flag to the cruiser Nagara. On the Kaga, a furious inferno trapped hundreds below deck with no hope. Numerous others perished in the water, lapped around by burning oil. The Soryu was left dead in the water and was blazing along her entire length. She was abandoned and later sank. It had taken a total of 9 accurately delivered bombs to eliminate half of Japan's first line carrier fleet. The Hiryu had escaped the onslaught, her parcel force of fighters and bombers still largely intact. Directly the planes of Hiryu had been serviced and repaired, he ordered a counterstrike which found the Yorktown. Forewarned by radar, the Yorktown discontinued her refueling operations. Her defense patrols went up to intercept the Japanese, and a fierce aerial combat ensued. Breaking through the melee, a group of dive bombers plunged down on the Yorktown and succeeded in scoring three hits. As the Japanese turned away, they had the satisfaction of seeing the Yorktown covered in smoke and bright flames. After their own terrible experience that morning, they were sure that the ship was finished. Yet she was not. The crew responded to the crisis with courage. The fires were extinguished, power and steering was regained, and the Yorktown could still fly off some aircraft. These were needed, for the Hiryu had sent off a second strike, which arrived mid-afternoon. Penetrating the weaker air defenses, the Japanese bombers roared in low and launched their torpedoes, two of which hit their target. Disabled and burning, the Yorktown was soon abandoned. Meantime, the Enterprise and Hornet were assembling their air strength for a last desperate strike against the Hiryu. For the second time that day, fortune favored the Americans. The dive bombers streaked down out of the sun, catching the exhausted Japanese totally unaware. Four bombs ripped into it, fuel tanks ignited, and fire traveled speedily through the decks. There was no chance of saving the great vessel. It was 5:10 in the afternoon and the Battle of Midway was over. The smaller force had defeated the larger. The Imperial Navy's magnificent carrier strike force, which that morning had sailed to battle with such proud hopes, had passed into oblivion. On the morning of June the 5th, Yamamoto was deeply disconsolate and shocked by the loss of his carriers. He called off the invasion. The Japanese ships turned away from Midway. It was the first conclusive naval defeat in the history of the rising sun. Although Midway had brought about a decisive and irreversible shift in the balance of power, a huge and grueling struggle had yet to be endured before the Americans and their allies achieved final victory. Within 2 years, another 14 fleet carriers and over 70 light escort carriers would come down American slipways. Arriving in the Pacific, they would fly off from their decks an invincible new generation of faster, better aircraft. Yamamoto told his men that the real fight was now won between Japanese discipline and American industrial might and technology, but he would not live to see the conclusion. In April 1943, American codebreakers discovered that Yamamoto was to make an inspection of frontline air bases. His aircraft was intercepted and shot down. Yamamoto died. Slowly, after a tortuous series of campaigns, the American forces clawed their way back bit by bit into island after island. As the Japanese Empire shrank and the character of the sea war in the Pacific changed, so did the role of the aircraft carrier. Increasingly, the carrier was used to provide air support for amphibious assaults or ground operations. Carriers also proved their value as an attack force against distant objectives. In November 1943, a surprise carrier strike devastated a large Japanese invasion fleet. The following February, another carrier-based assault hit the Japanese base at Turk Island, dropping 30 times the weight of bombs dropped at Pearl Harbor. The Americans did not need to capture the island. Instead, its garrison was simply sidestepped and left to wither on the vine. By this means, much time and many lives were saved. the effectiveness of Japan's carrier force had sharply deteriorated. There was a crucial shortage of trained pilots, and the summer of 1944 saw the last naval engagement to be fought principally by contending carrier groups. Dozens of warships and hundreds of Japanese land-based aircraft also participated. The Battle of the Philippine Sea commenced on the morning of June 19th, when the Japanese carriers launched their first airstrike. Throughout the day, the skies echoed with the sound of cannons and machine gun fire from innumerable dogfights. The outcome was a massacre, in which returning American pilots shot down over 400 enemy aircraft for the loss of 30 of their own. Meanwhile, American submarines had intervened to deadly effect with enormous loss of life. Although further great battles were yet to come, the American carriers were increasingly deployed not as independent strike forces, but rather as integrated components in the vast combined defenses, advancing with ever-gathering might against the Japanese mainland. Despite the dwindling resistance, at no stage of the Pacific War could any ship feel completely safe. It was always the carriers whose destruction was most eagerly sought by the Japanese. Accordingly, it was the men on the carriers who first experienced the terror of a fearsome new Japanese tactic which appeared in late 1944. The kamikaze was the first effective guided missile. The projectile was a fast aircraft, its warhead a cargo of high explosives. The highly accurate guidance system was a human pilot devoted to certain death for the greater glory of the Sun Emperor. The kamikaze were seen by the Japanese commanders as offering the capability to create maximum destruction on the enemy with a minimal outlay. In 1945, the kamikaze pilots appeared in greater numbers, claiming a number of victims. Although the majority of kamikazes were shot down or missed their target, the few that did get through caused appalling damage and casualties. Their effect in material tons was limited, but as a weapon of terror, they caused panic disproportionate to their numbers. Air patrols were increased, vigilance was sharpened, and the kamikazes were usually destroyed on the way in, but the suicide pilots posed a seemingly unsolvable riddle. Kamikaze attacks were a significant factor behind the decision to use atomic weapons on Japan in August 1945. The crowds awaiting returning American servicemen were as glad and as jubilant as were those rejoicing the end of the Great War in 1918. But in one respect, this homecoming was different. For as the ship steamed slowly in, it was the aircraft carrier, not the battleship, that held pride of place. The day of the carrier had dawned. In Western Europe and the United States, the euphoria that ended one great conflict was quickly allayed by the beginning of another. The Cold War would last more than 50 years. During that period, the enmity of the superpowers would find fierce expression in localized but violent wars fought around the Third World. Secure in the possession of her atomic arsenal, the United States had rapidly run down her conventional armed forces and was ill-prepared for the sudden outbreak of war in Korea in mid-1950. Fortunately, one British and one American carrier were in the Pacific and raced to the scene. They were quickly joined by other carriers during the desperate struggle to hold the Pusan perimeter, which the Chinese troops were on the verge of overrunning. The North Koreans were successfully held at bay while the perimeter was reinforced. That autumn, seaborne air pilots again proved indispensable during the Incheon landings, a spectacular military operation which turned the course of the war. The invaders were driven out of the south, and eventually the war ended in uneasy terms. For the West, Korea had proved the continued need for strong conventional forces, and once again had underlined the immense value of the carrier aircraft. The carrier's unique combination of striking power and flexible deployment created the essential component in a modern worldwide peacekeeping force.